Hello, and welcome to the IRF and LTEC training part one. I'm Brenda Karkas, and I'll be presenting Section O, Special Treatments, Procedures, and Programs. I'm a registered nurse with experience in direct patient care, education, and nursing administration. My experience includes inpatient care, outpatient oncology, home health, and the hospice settings. Currently, I'm an associate at Apt Associates in Cambridge, Mass. So at the conclusion of this training, you should be able to describe the new and revised data elements in Section O, discuss the data sources that can be used to code these items, and describe the intent, coding instructions, and the definitions for the items. For the IRF setting, this section is all new in the IRF-PAI. This is a bit different for the LTEC setting because in that setting, there were already some data elements in O0110. However, most of these data elements are also completely new for LTEC. Here are just some of the changes and updates to note in the LCDS. O0110N, total parenteral nutrition, has been removed. O0150, SBT, by day two of the LTEC stay, has a clarification of the day two definition, a skip pattern change, and an additional response option for O0150A2 ventilator weaning status. O0200 ventilator liberation rate also has a clarification of the day two definition and some minor wording changes. And then lastly, O0250 influenza vaccine has been removed. So now let's take a closer look at what is included in this section, special treatments, procedures, and programs. Here is the intent and the rationale for these items. The intent is to identify any special treatments, procedures, and programs that may apply to the patient. And the rationale is that any of those listed can have a profound effect on an individual's health status, their self-image, their dignity, and certainly their quality of life. So here's a screenshot of Section O. For the IRF-PAI, all of these are the same data elements that will be collected on admission and again at discharge. The admission items are collected in column A, and the discharge items are collected in a column labeled column C at discharge, but that is currently hidden by this screenshot. For the LTEC setting, here is what Section O used to look like. You'll see that this list has been expanded to include all of the items you just saw in the last screenshot for the IRF-PAI. So for the LCDS, this is the same comprehensive list we saw for the IRF-PAI. These same elements will be collected in column A at admission and column C at discharge. The one exception is F1, invasive mechanical ventilator. You can see the blue arrow pointing to F1 in this screenshot. This element is collected only at discharge in the LCDS. So here's a list of some of the data sources that can be used to complete these items. These might include the medical record, whether it be paper or electronic health record, from wherever the patient received care that included these treatments, programs, procedures, and medications. You can also include clinical communication or notes. These might be notes from the pharmacy, nursing staff, or documentation from the physician or physician designee. And you might also include recent documents, such as the patient's history and physical, a discharge summary, or any transfer documents. And the last data source would be any discussions with hospital staff, the patient, their family, or perhaps their caregivers. The steps for assessment for both admission and at discharge are the same. It's expected that you would review the patient's medical record and consult with the patient, family, and staff to determine whether or not any of these apply. And then check each type of treatment, procedure, or program that's applicable to the patient. Now let's review some of the coding instructions for O0110. You would complete these at admission and discharge. One difference in the guidance for the LCDS is that it notes that you would only complete this if the response to A0250 is equal to O1 admission, and upon discharge, complete only if A0250 is equal to 10 planned discharge or 11 unplanned discharge. A few more coding instructions are here. You'll check all that apply for admission and discharge, and if the patient is currently undergoing treatment for chemotherapy, radiation, or dialysis, these would also be checked. And if none of these apply on admission or discharge, check Z1, none of the above. Now let's go over some general coding tips. Check all treatments, programs, and procedures that are part of the patient's current care or treatment plan. Include those performed by others and those the patient performed themselves independently, even after set up by a staff member, family, or caregiver. You're going to check those that are performed in the care setting you're in or in another setting like dialysis that might be given in a dialysis center. Do not include services provided solely in conjunction with a surgical or diagnostic procedure. One example would be some IV medication that might be given during a procedure. Next, let's look at some specific coding tips for these treatments and procedures. These next few slides have some chemotherapy specific tips. You would code any type of chemotherapy medication administered as an antineoplastic for cancer treatment given by any route. You'll need to assess each medication to determine the reason it's used to be sure that the medication is actually being used as a cancer treatment. The example here mentions megestrol acetate, which is classified as an antineoplastic medication. However, many times this medication is only used for appetite stimulation. If that's the case, then you would not code it as chemotherapy since the patient is not receiving the medication to treat cancer. And here are a few more coding tips for chemotherapy. You would check IV if the chemo was administered intravenously and oral if the chemotherapy was in pill or liquid form. One important note is that the term oral also applies if the chemo is administered through a feeding or a PEG tube. And the last chemotherapy tip is that you would check other if the chemo was given another way and not given IV or orally. Some examples are listed here, but these might include IM, intrathecal, intraperitoneal, or even topical routes, such as some of the creams that are used to treat skin lesions. Now a tip for radiation. O0110B1. For this item, you would code intermittent radiation therapy as well as radiation administered through a radiation implant. One example of this might be prostate implants. Now let's walk through the next few slides to cover some of the tips for coding oxygen. Here, you code continuous or intermittent oxygen administered via a mask or a cannula delivered to relieve hypoxia. You would also code oxygen used in BiPAP or CPAP here, even if the patient places or removes their own oxygen mask or cannula. You would not code hyperbaric oxygen for wound therapy. And here are a list of the different options under oxygen therapy. You would check C2 continuous if the oxygen was being administered continuously delivered for greater than equal or within or equal to 14 hours a day. C3 intermittent would be used if the oxygen was intermittent, which is defined as not delivered continuously for at least 14 hours per day. And C4 high concentration would be the response if the oxygen therapy was delivered through a high concentration delivery system. So just a few more details about C4 high concentration. A high concentration oxygen delivery system is one that delivers oxygen that exceeds an FiO2 of 40%. This means that it exceeds that of a simple low flow nasal cannula at a flow rate of 4 liters per minute. These can include either high or low flow systems, for example, a simple face mask, and may also include devices such as invasive mechanical ventilators, non-invasive mechanical ventilators, and trach masks. but only if the delivered FiO2 of these systems exceeds 40%. Now let's look at a few tips on D1 suctioning. You would only code tracheal and or nasopharyngeal suctioning in this item, even if the patient performs their own suctioning. Oral suctioning would not be included here. And for suctioning, these are also items that pertain to whether it is scheduled or as needed. You would check scheduled if the suctioning was scheduled for something like every hour or once a shift, and check as needed if the suctioning is only on an as-needed basis. An example of this might be if the patient has copious secretions that needed to be handled by an occasional suctioning. For E1 tracheostomy care, you would code the cleansing of the tracheostomy and or the cannula. And this would also be checked even if the patient performs their own trach care or receives assistance with it. Now let's look at O0110F1 invasive mechanical ventilator. This is for both the IRF and LTEC settings, but as I mentioned earlier, for the LCDS, this would only be coded on discharge. For patients with a ventilator or a respirator, code any type of electrically or pneumatically powered closed system mechanical ventilator in the patient who is or who may become unable to support their own respirations. This is when the patient's breathing is controlled by the ventilator. You would not code this item when the ventilator is used only as a substitute for BiPAP or CPAP. For G1 non-invasive mechanical ventilator, you would code any type of CPAP or BiPAP device. If a ventilator is being used as a substitute for BiPAP or CPAP, you would also code that here. But you would not check G2 or G3, which is specifically for BiPAP or CPAP. This item may also be checked whether the patient places or removes their own device and if the facility staff applies it or assists the patient with it. For H1 IV medications, code any medication or biological given by IV push through an epidural pump or through a central or peripheral port. This includes epidural, intrathecal, and baclofen pumps, since these are similar to IV medications and need frequent monitoring. You do not include flushes to keep an IV access patent, IV fluids without medication, or a sub-Q pump. You also do not include IV meds administered during dialysis or chemo, or IVs with just dextrose 50% and or lactated ringers. And a few more coding tips on H1 IV medications. You would code vasoactive medications when at least one of the IV medications was a vasoactive medication. H3 antibiotics when at least one of the IV medications was an antibiotic. And H4 anticoagulation when at least one of the IV medications is an IV anticoagulant. You would not include the sub-Q administration of anticoagulant medications such as sub-Q heparin. Check H10, other, if at least one of the IV medications was not an IV vasoactive medication, IV antibiotic, or an IV anticoagulant. An example of these might be morphine or IV diuretics such as furosemide. So for I1 transfusions, here you would code transfusions of blood and any blood products. However, as we mentioned in many of the other items, you would not code any transfusions that were administered during dialysis or chemotherapy. For J1 dialysis, code peritoneal or renal dialysis, which occurs at the LTEC, IRF, or even at another facility, or if the patient performs their own dialysis. Here you would also code treatments of hemofiltration, slow continuous ultrafiltration, continuous arteriovenous hemofiltration, and continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. IVs, IV medication and blood transfusions administered during dialysis are considered part of the dialysis procedure and are not to be coded under items K0520A, parenteral IV feeding, O0110H1 IV medications, or O0110I1 transfusions. And a few other tips regarding dialysis. Here you would indicate the type of dialysis as it pertains to the patient. So code J2, hemodialysis, or J1, peritoneal dialysis. And just one last coding tip for IV access. This is just to indicate the type of access as it pertains to the patient. You would check O2 peripheral if the access was and remains peripheral, O3 midline, or O4 for central access, such as a PICC line. So to summarize, you should now be able to describe the new and revised data elements in Section O, outline the data sources that you can use to code these items, and describe the intent of Section O, as well as many of the tips to help you in completing this item. If you'd like to submit a question regarding this presentation, please send it to the PAC training at econometricainc.com by June 3rd. As a reminder, a practice coding workshop will be held in June, and we encourage you to attend. Select questions will be answered in a Q&A session during this June 2022 virtual live event. Thank you for reviewing the presentation. We do look forward to your attendance at the coding workshop.